Oh my God. Becky, look at her big laptop. A while ago, I made a video about an HP 8470. Well, this is its big brother. This is the HP 8570. And the main thing you'll notice about this guy is that it's 1 inch bigger. But not only is it 1 inch bigger, it carries a bit more weight. And not just weight, as in it's damn big, which it is, because it has like this extra wide keyboard now. But it does have the number pad. And this is an i7 quad core. So this thing is beefy. This is what they would call a workstation. And by workstation, I mean this is the kind of thing that sits in your desk and you are meant to work at it. Now, the keyboard is fine. Like I said, you can add an external keyboard to it. They're pretty similar in size when you think about it. And that's a full-size keyboard. So this machine is meant to be productive. It's also a quad core, so it's got a little bit of kick to it. One thing I don't understand is this. I didn't understand it in the last one. I don't understand it in this one. What is the point of that light? It's supposed to light up the keyboard, but it doesn't. Let me see if I can fit a night shot in here. What does that do? Nothing. You get more light from the screen than you do from the light. Okay, so let's take a closer look at it from the back left. USB, powered USB, underneath the two of them is the SD card reader. See it in there? Firewire, ventilation for the CPU, eSATA, VGA, smart card reader underneath here. This pops out, it looks like the PCM CIA. People can't memorize idiotic computer acronyms. If that helps at all, doesn't help me. No idea what that is or what it's for. You can see the smart card reader right there. On the front and the bottom, you got a couple speaker grills. One's right here. The other one's right there. And I think this is where the SIM card tray goes. On the front left, we have some status lights that tell you what's going on. This is your button that opens up the lid. I'm knocking things left, right, and center here. Headphone, microphone, high speed, well, super speed. Super speed USB, super speed USB, optical drive. That's your optical drive in the bottom. And the good thing with the optical drive is it does eject, obviously, but you can replace that with a battery or you can replace that with a tray for more storage. We have a network port, Kensington lock, modem, 9-pin input, output. That one's slightly bent, slightly. That one's tortured. Power, battery, and way over here, if I can get to it, is a display port. And that's the walk around of it. Let's take a look on the inside. Now, like I said, this is a large keyboard. And there's a couple things I really do like about this. One, power button top left, power button. Wi-Fi, internet, mute, and I think that's calculator. I guess that's why it's a business machine with the mathematical keyboard over here, like the calculator. You're going to want the calculator button. You have a large mouse pad here, like that's a really large trackpad. And apparently that's a glass, and this is probably one of the very first machines to start using that beside the MacBook Air. You have two sets of mouse buttons here, and they're really responsive. Trackpad in the middle, nice chiclet keyboard. It's really quite comfortable too. I really like typing on this machine. I found the 8470 was spreading my fingers a bit. The 8570, yeah, it just feels more natural. I think that's because the keyboard itself is so close to being the size of a regular keyboard, one that you would actually use on your typical desktop. It's a really comfortable machine. I almost don't want to sell it. But really, what am I going to do with it? Now, I have a couple quick thoughts on this machine. I have installed Ubuntu, and I installed Windows. I had a little bit of an issue installing Windows, as you'll see here.
So I'm installing Windows on this HP, what is it again? Elitebook 8570P. And I think we got a problem, Houston. Oh, I can't go over the mouse that far. Ah, Windows. Anyway, you get the picture.
And then when I ran Ubuntu worked fine on it. I really enjoyed it, and it did everything I needed it to do with Ubuntu. Picked up the Wi-Fi, no problem. It picked up everything we needed it to pick up. I mean, I had zero issues with this machine. Oh, and cheese. Let's see if the camera works. There I am with my quarantine hair. Wow. Not good. Not good at all. Ooh, white balance takes a second to catch on, but still, not bad considering that the, it just went out there and it dug up its own drivers for this. I think that's pretty impressive. But now, as a Windows machine, it runs just fine too. And now this is the i7 quad, 180 gig SSD, 8 gigs of RAM. This is a nice machine for your parents. Because it is thick and bulky. It is heavy, and it's wide, and it just takes up a lot of space. Just to give you an idea, let's measure it really quick. This is a Lenovo X240. Bit of a size difference. This is the Dell XPS 13. Bit of a size difference. And this is a tape measure. Okay, we are talking 14 and a half inches wide, 10 inches deep, and approximately 1.5 inches thick. That's a thick machine. And our handy dandy scale. It is in ounces. Ooh. Does that mean 6 pounds and 5.2 ounces? In kilograms, that's 2.870 kilograms. That's a beefy, meaty machine. You can see what I do like about this. It has a docking station on the bottom, really easy to access. Let's dive in here for 2 seconds. So one of these takes up the battery, one of these takes off the base. When you get into the bottom of it, you'll see it has 2 RAM slots. This is your hard drive down over here. This is your optical buried under there. Like I said, with the optical, you can pull that out, put in more storage, or you can put in another battery. This is why I thought this was where the SIM card, That's why I thought that's where the SIM card went, because there's this empty cable that's doing absolutely nothing in there. This is your CPU cooler. Seems not too bad. And back there's your Wi-Fi card, which I was thinking of putting into my Dell XPS 13, but that's another story. Really easy to assemble, though. Such a great machine to work on. Okay, let's plug this in so we know it's got power. We don't want to starve it. And we shall do the boot test, which really isn't much to say because it's running right now Windows. And I should have did it with Ubuntu on there. But it's plugged in, SSD. Let's see how long it takes. 3, 2, 1, go. HP. It's an updated BIOS. It's Windows 10 Pro. I just did all the updates on Windows 10, by the way. So it should be good to go. Wow, that was fast. Like I said, this is a workhorse. This is the kind of machine that you would want to type reports on if you're doing schoolwork. Or if you're going to sit there and actually work from home. This would be a meaty enough machine to do it. And you could get a docking station. You can plug in an external monitor. But look at this. Not, no matter what I do, there it goes. See, I don't know if I would count that as a true time. Steam annoys me. We'll get rid of it. And while that we're here, let's take a look at the benchmark on it at the same time, and we'll see what kind of goods this thing has inside it. So this is the app called the, I think it's called the User Benchmark. I'll leave the link for it below. But basically you install it, you let it run its tests, and what it's going to do is it's going to go through the video, it's going to go through the memory, it's going to run a bunch of tests, and it's going to compare them to other CPUs that are out there. So I'm going to put this in a fast forward for a few minutes. I'm going to let some music play, and I'm just going to let it roll. So sit there, enjoy it, kick back, watch what happens, and we'll take a look at the score as soon as we're done. Okay, well, nothing too surprising here. Like I said, this is probably not really a gaming machine, because what's slowing it down is the lack of a video card. You go through it all and everything seems fairly normal, like it's a good processor, but once you hit that video card, this machine just sinks. It's not meant to do that kind of work. Hard drive is fine, memory is fine, CPU is fine. It's great for doing work, and like I said, classwork and typing, but you're not going to be able to play any games on this machine, which is kind of too bad. Minimize this. So, right now you can see that this is an i7-3740 quad CPU, 8 gigs of RAM, and you see it shows two slots, two of two, available. It should be 8 gigs, yeah, 8 gigs of RAM. There's hard drive one, so that is an SSD 180 gig. Yeah, 180 gigs, that's 180 gig SSD. Disk two is that external drive, 750 gig, doesn't show the speed. Wi-Fi is connected to the Wi-Fi. That's a Centrino Advanced N6205. All right, that's all running. Now, we'll try playing Fortnite really quick. Oh my God, really? An update of all times to do an update. Now let's do an update. Update. Patching was unsuccessful. Please try again later. Can I run it without the update? Maybe not. We have a Grand Theft Auto. Can I run that? Installing. Verifying. Install integrity check has failed. Common causes include incomplete download and damaged media. Well, I was playing Fortnite a while ago. Hopefully I still have that recording. Okay, so this is going to be a bit of a Frankenstein here, but this clip is from what I recorded earlier on the 8570 when I was using OBS. I recorded it. It recorded in MKV file or format, which I wasn't really familiar with. I didn't realize that Final Cut Pro couldn't import it. So I had to take that clip now, and now I'm playing it on QuickTime, and I'm recording this. So this is like basically a recording of a recording of a recording. So that's why the graphics might not look too well. But when I first started playing this on the HP, the 8570, this is how it looked. It was playing pretty well. I was having no issues with it. I was just kind of poking around and trying my best, and it worked out fine. I couldn't get Grand Theft Auto 5 to load, but I had no issues with Fortnite. But now it's keeps asking me for an update to Fortnite, and I just can't get anywhere. So I flew over here, I landed, I grabbed that helicopter, then I got killed. There weren't really a lot of people playing at the same time. I don't know if that game's losing its popularity or what, but this was able to play Fortnite, but just not Grand Theft Auto. Okay, so one thing I do like about this is the screen size. You can go take a look at that right here. It's a 1920 by 1080 screen. And it runs Windows, obviously, really well. There's no sense testing the speakers. You know, that's one thing I do like about the Linux, is that I can click test speakers. Here I can't really seem to. Battery on this particular machine, 96. Okay, well, right now you'll see battery. Here we are. 96% available. Now if I unplug it, which I'll do here. Wow, the fan noise really stopped. That's interesting too. So we'll just wait around. The brightness obviously dropped down. I'm going to wait a moment to see what the time pops up with the battery. Because usually it will say, you know, 1 hour available or whatever it might be. And in the meantime, we'll go back into settings and take a look at this again. Tablet mode. This is definitely not a tablet. Storage, 180 gig SSD. I would put a larger, like if I was going to keep this machine, 8 gigs of RAM is probably enough. I would throw in 16 if I could. It's easy to access. I'd throw a 512 gig SSD in there. I think you would notice a huge difference in the machine for hardware. Let's go into Device Manager if we can, just to make sure all the drivers are updated. Device Manager, there we are. What is this? Base system device. That seems to be the only one, an HP mobile data protection sensor. Okay, so base device, I don't know what that is. This might be that cable that I was mentioning that was just kind of sitting there. All right, and back to the battery. 1 hour, 22 minutes left. You know, I think it'll get longer than that. I'm going to play this myself, but this is a 2014 model, I think. Maybe 2014 or, yeah, 2014. Maybe a little older. So that is the original battery. If you bought a new battery, you'd probably get a lot more juice out of it. So something to keep in mind when you're out shopping for them. Okay, so I think we've basically covered everything we need to cover on this machine. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments below. I'm going to have this for a little while. You can always go to mikedancy.com to read more about it. At least hopefully I'll write something in there. Have I not actually gone to my website with this thing? Isn't that a beautiful website? Actually, it's kind of ugly. I need to do a redo. But I will try and add more thoughts to it in there. If you like these kind of videos, leave a thumbs up. And if you don't, leave a thumbs down. I'm easy either way. Hit that subscribe button and that bell right there somewhere. And I do appreciate you watching this video with me. I do plan on selling this machine. And you know what? Fun fact, these machines actually do hold their value really well. Now, I think I paid around $200 Canadian for it, give or take. A little bit less, but then I had to add some parts to it. So if I type in here, HP 8570P, and I search. And the thing is, when you do the search, so you'll see some here for sale, 250, 225, 250, 360. Don't look at any of that. On the left-hand side is a little box. That little box says sold listings. You click it, and then you'll see what the actual sale price is. $166 for the i5-3320 with 4 gigs of RAM and 120 gig SSD and Linux. $170 of Linux installed. Good for him. $350 for the i5 with 250 gig SSD and Win 10 Pro. i5, $250. There's two of them for $560. So this machine, I should be able to get three and change for. Question is, am I going to sell it on eBay or am I going to sell it on Facebook Marketplace? Type in i7, $405 for the 3630, 8 gigs with a new 500 gig drive. Who cares about that? $3740, that's the same as this one. 16 gigs of RAM, which this does not have, and a 750 drive. $538. What are they smoking? Seriously, who would pay $500 for this? This is like a 2014 laptop. Those are insane prices. $265 with the 1 terabyte. 1 terabyte is probably the slowest hard drive you can put in there. $533 for a 750 gig drive, which is also a slow drive. I'm going to rethink selling this and selling it soon. Okay, thanks for watching. And if you like this kind of video, stay tuned for my next one, which will be the HP 8460. That's an i7 second gen. Sweet machine, a lot like this. Pretty damn heavy, but I'm looking forward to it. That won't go in the video.